Hey, what's going on, everyone? Today we're going to do a full review of the Mi Max 3, the budget beast from Xiaomi. Now, question of the day, what device do you want to see me review next? Leave a comment down below. I'll make sure to take a look and try to get a hold of that device. Now, time codes for everything in this review will be down in the description. If you want to jump around, by all means, feel free. The categories we're going to cover today are the price and specs, the camera, the Android skin, the screen, the battery, the audio quality, the fingerprint sensor, living with the Mi Max 3, and finally, my conclusions and final thoughts. Now, quick disclaimer, I did buy this phone with my own money. This is not a review unit. It was not sent to me for free. I spent my own money on this phone, so I'm gonna try to be as objective as I possibly can be. All right, price and specs. Snapdragon 636, 4 gigs of RAM, 64 gigs of storage. This is the official global version of the phone. And as of right now, those are the only storage and processor specs you can get when you get the global version. Camera-wise, 12 megapixel camera with a 5 megapixel sensor. That's a Sony sensor for both cameras. The star of the show, of course, is a 6.9 inch 1080p LCD display. And it has a 5,500 mAh battery. Those are the specs, pretty boring. What do they mean? We're gonna find out here in this review. So, the camera, just mentioned it. Sony sensors, a 12 megapixel main sensor and a 5 megapixel secondary sensor. Those are the rear cameras there. They do really well, especially for a phone that's around 250 bucks. Definitely a solid package. I can't really complain too much. Let me pull up a couple of pictures here. Not Snapchat. Snapchat sucks on Android, by the way. And not Capital One. I don't want you guys seeing that info. Well, it wants to fire up anyway. So, picture-wise, here's a couple pictures that I took from my backyard, if I can hit the right button there from behind the camera. So I took these the other day. It was nice and sunny out. And now, take these with a grain of salt because you're looking at these pictures on a phone screen through a camera lens on whatever device you're watching this video on. So they're not going to look the greatest. But I mean, the pictures look pretty good. The detail looks pretty decent overall. One thing I'll draw your attention to on this shot though, if you look at the back, where the sun is setting there, the camera just doesn't know how to handle it. It's really blown out. Now, in context, the picture looks fine, right? But it's just something to keep in mind there. So they're decent, they're not great. You should not expect flagship performance, but they do fine for a phone of this price. Now, what about the front camera? I don't remember the megapixel count offhand, and I really don't care. And the reason for that is, with the front camera, I don't take many selfies. What you're primarily gonna do is probably Snapchat or video chat. Now, if you video chat, it's going to be more dependent on your cell signal than anything as far as the quality of the video stream you get. And for Snapchat, it just sucks on Android. It's so poorly written. So the camera is going to do just fine. I mean, having a stellar front-facing camera, it doesn't really matter on Android at the moment, which is sad, but it is what it is. The camera does fine. The front-facing camera specs, I don't care about. Now the Android skin, which is MIUI, and the performance. To level set with you guys, MIUI is my favorite Android skin. I think it delivers a lot of features and is really well optimized regardless of what kind of phone you're running it on. And the Max 3 is really no exception. Now I did a video for MIUI 10 on the Max 3, which is on my channel. If you're interested in it, I'll link it down below. Let me just call your attention to the main thing that I love about MIUI 10. This is the recent apps. It's not like any other recent apps you've probably seen on an Android device. You get two apps side by side here. You can see a lot of content really easily. You can long press an app. You can run it in dual app mode. You can lock it to where if you clear all, it won't clear that app. And jump straight into the app settings. To clear an app like Capital One, which I opened by mistake, just swipe it to one side. It doesn't matter. You can swipe it whichever side you want. I just think it's a great implementation. Clear all, you got that nice X that's always there. And boom, we're done. MIUI 10 is awesome. This phone has a Snapdragon 636. No joke, you guys. It opened some apps faster than my Galaxy Note 9. which has a Snapdragon 845. This app called The Score, that's my primary scores app. This phone at least felt like it was opening apps faster than my Note 9 did, but that could just be me. I've got airplane mode on right now for this video, so it's not gonna pull it up, of course, but yeah, it ran really, really smoothly. Now, one thing to note about MIUI 10, at least on this phone, on a budget Xiaomi phone, it does have ads, and that sucks. I mean, that sucks. I don't know why you put that in your software. I wish they would take it out or let me pay like an extra $20 to not have ads. So the bad news is the ads are there. The good news is though, you can disable the ads. It's not too difficult. You do have to do it app by app, at least with this phone and the global version, but you can disable them. So just something to keep in mind. Performance is great, UI is great, but ads are present. Now, the screen. Let me crank the brightness here on the screen. We've got a 6.9-inch 1080p LCD display. Now, this phone screen does look kind of washed out in my opinion when you have something next to it, especially like a flagship, like something with an AMOLED screen, right? Like a OnePlus 6 or a Galaxy Note 9 or one of the new Huawei Mate 20s. It looks washed out side by side one of those phones, but by itself, it looks fine. I mean, it really looks just fine. One thing I will say, I'm gonna jump in the settings here to show you guys. If you go in the settings and look up contrast, when you get this phone out of the box, it's going to look even more washed out than it already does. And the reason is, if we jump here into contrast and colors, automatic contrast is selected by default. So when the proximity sensors and the sensors up there at the top of the phone detect you're in the sunlight, it tries to boost everything on the screen to make it more, you know, more readable. But what it ends up doing is washing out colors. So in an app like Textra, where I have a dark background, it looked more light gray than dark. Once I switched this to an increased contrast, the problem went away. Just something to note, if you got a Mi Max 3 and you're worried about that issue, or if you pick one of these up, you know, just switch it to increased contrast right off the gate and you're not gonna have an issue. Now, as far as the screen looking washed out as a whole compared to some other flagships, here's a good analogy for it. I sold TVs in college. And you know, you got this wall of TVs, some are $500, some are $5,000, and you got somebody that comes in that really can't afford a $5,000 TV, but it's like, man, you know, I got this old tube TV at my house, and this $500 TV is what I can afford, but man, that $5,000 TV, that 4K, Sony, whatever, looks stellar. It's like, dude, when you get home, and this TV is the only thing that you have in your house to look at, it's gonna look great. The old TV that you had, especially if you guys are coming from another budget phone, it's gonna look stellar. You only notice the difference side by side some other flagship, and those looks might even be deceiving. For example, Samsung would boost their brightness to make the TVs catch your eyes, but color-wise, they weren't as accurate as LG or Sony, but I digress. Those are TVs, not phones. So the phone screen looks just fine. I don't have any complaints about color and day-to-day use, just it's not going to be as vivid as one of the newer OLED displays on a top-specced flagship. Battery life. The battery. We're rocking a 5,500 milliamp hour battery inside this phone. The back of the phone's fine. We just got some grips, which I'll get to in my living with the Mi Max 3 section here later in this video, but 5,500 milliamp hour battery. I'm getting about 2 days on the battery, so that's, we'll say 40 to 48 hours on the battery itself, with about 9 to 10 hours screen on time, about 3 hours of streaming video, and another hour or two of streaming audio, you know, podcast, Spotify, whatever it may be. That's pretty solid. I mean, when you consider phones, I consider good battery life to be 5 to 6 hours screen on time. If I'm getting 10, that's 2 days, you know, day and a half, 2 days, I can stretch it to 2 days if I need to. Again, for full transparency, we got the brightness crease for the sake of this video. I usually rock my brightness between 40 and 50%, so right around there. Again, this is on camera, so it's gonna look a lot darker than it does in real life. And I promise the UI is responsive. I'm just trying to do this behind a camera, which makes it a little bit difficult, but anyway, brightness 40 to 50%. We'll call it 3 to 4 hours streaming, 9 to 10 hours screen on time with 40 to 48 hours on the battery itself. Now, what about charging? This thing charges in about 2 hours. Two and a half hours, I mean, what I do, I leave work at like 5 every day. I plug the phone in about 3. unplug it before I leave, and I'm solid. So the battery I have no issues with. I never worry about running out of battery on this phone. Battery is stellar, and it's really hard to go to something else just for the battery, if nothing else. All right, so audio quality and speakers. The speaker on this phone, here at the bottom, we've got, you can see two speaker grills. Sound only comes out of one of them. They do the Apple thing. The other grill is just a microphone. Here at the top, no speaker. We do have a headphone jack though. This earpiece actually doubles as a secondary speaker. Now, that earpiece isn't that big, so the speakers get nice and loud, but the overall quality is kind of lacking. You know, it's not super balanced. The bass presence isn't super heavy. If you're listening to a podcast or something like that, it's gonna do you just fine. I don't have many complaints about the speakers. It just could be more balanced. You know, the bass could be there more. It could be better for music, but it does get nice and loud. And again, for a $250 phone, the speakers are solid. Now, fingerprint sensor. Here on the back, you can see the fingerprint sensor is a circle. It's closer to the top of the phone than I'd prefer. I'd actually prefer it be down a little bit further, but the fingerprint sensor is pretty solid. So again, reaching around my camera contraption here, screen is locked. I'm gonna try to do this little thing where you guys can see how quickly it opens. Xiaomi's got some of the best fingerprint sensors in the game, and this phone is no different. Now, Huawei's fingerprint sensors are still the fastest I've ever used, but on a phone of this price, the sensor is awesome. I think part of that also has to do with Xiaomi's OS, going back to the skin that they have on top of Android. Over here, I've also got a Mi A2, which I'll be doing a video on here soon. You can see similar setup for the fingerprint sensor, but it is far slower and far less accurate than it is on the Mi Max 3. So I think part of it is the sensor itself. Part of it is Xiaomi's skin. It is what it is. All right, so finally, we're to living with the Mi Max 3. What's it like living with a phone this big? What's the performance like, the reception, the battery? What's this actually like in day-to-day use? How does this translate? Great questions. So reception's been good overall. LTE's been kind of spotty though. I've been using this on AT&T. Again, right now we're on airplane mode, so you can't see the little AT&T logo there at the top. But I've been using it on AT&T, and despite this being the global version of the phone, LTE has been spotty. And that comes down to the LTE bands that are on the phone. So this is something that's publicly available. If you go on gearbest.com, I'm not affiliated with them. I've just used the site before, and I've always had a good experience with them. Gearbest.com, they'll tell you what LTE bands this phone has, so you can see if it works in the area that you live in personally. For me, I get LTE sometimes. Most of the time though, it's HSPA or HSPA Plus, which is fine, just not, you know, the LTE speed you expect from a more expensive device. Like I said earlier, the phone does have ads. They can be disabled, but they are still there. They are still annoying. We'll try to jump into the file manager here. I'm on airplane mode, so they're probably not gonna come up, but anyway, there are ads there you can disable. It's just more of an annoyance than anything. As far as the size of the phone, that's what's gonna hold a lot of people up. Let me bust out my Galaxy Mega 6.3. This phone came out in 2012 or 2013, I forget which. 6.3 inch screen at a 16:9 aspect ratio. The Max 3, 18:9 aspect ratio. So why am I bringing up the Mega? You know, it's about the same width, a hair wider. The Mega is a hair taller, or I'm sorry, the Max is a hair taller than the Mega. Why bring up this phone over the when I'm talking about the Max 3? The reason is when this Mega came out, it was lower spec, but whatever Samsung did with touch was at the time, it was so well optimized. The camera was pretty decent at the time. Speaker got loud enough. The battery life was insane. This was actually rocking a 720p screen when it came out. So this was a budget phone, and just for the package it delivered for the money, if you wanted a true phablet, man, this thing was hard to beat once you got used to carrying around a phone this big. The Mi Max 3 is pretty much the same thing. You know, once you get a phone this big, again, we'll pull back in the Mi A2 just for comparison's sake. The Mi A2, a 6-inch screen versus 6.9. You can kind of see them side by side. When you first get this phone, it's going to feel too big. Reminded me of the Mega, reminded me of the Galaxy Note 2 way back in the day. It's like, man, I made a mistake going with a phone this big. But once you get used to it, let me pull up the keyboard here, make sure I'm not putting anybody on blast, because we obviously don't want to do that. All right, keyboard there. Once you get used to this big keyboard, once you get used to the 2-day battery life, once you get used to having consistently smooth performance, it's really hard to switch to a different phone. A battery that lasts this long, a phone that runs this smooth, a camera that's decent enough at this price point of about $250. Man, I'm not exaggerating when I say this is my favorite phone I've used in 2018. My only gripe with it is that I wish it worked better on LTE here in the States. If it did, I'd have no reason to switch phones to something else. Something else to call your attention to real quick. This is more hardware specific. If you see here on the phone itself, you see these like raised edges there. It's kind of hard to capture on video, but it's not all from the back straight curve to the front glass. That's not a big deal to me. On the Mi A2, you can kind of see this, but it's, you know, less so. It's just something Xiaomi does on their budget devices. It's not a nice unibody, if you will, design. That just kind of comes with the price that you're paying, in my opinion. Doesn't bother me at all, just something to note. Some people call it out to make it a big deal. I don't think it is. So my conclusion and final thoughts. If you are at all considering the Max 3, go for it. If the size is the only thing holding you back, go for it. You're gonna think you made a mistake for the first day or two. Stick with it, keep using the phone, you're gonna love it. It's just, you know, it's one of those devices. It's weird, like I said. The Galaxy Mega 6.3, a lower spec device that ran super smooth at the time and was a humongous phone at the time, and still is today when you look at the aspect ratio of 16:9 versus 18:9. That's the only thing I have to compare it to, man. Runs super smooth, delivers a great user experience, and once you're used to having that big of a screen, it's hard to go back. Anyway, guys, thank you so much for watching. Again, don't forget to leave a comment down below. Let me know what phone you want to see me review next. I currently have the Redmi Note 6 Pro on deck, and maybe a brief video on the Mi A2. Thanks so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one.